The stage is set at the House of Representatives as President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is set to deliver his second State of the Nation address in just a couple of hours. Katrina Domingo now joins us live for the latest from the Batasang Pambansa. Kat, go ahead.
Ron, the pomp and pageantry has already begun here at the Batasang Pambansa hours before the arrival of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. for his second State of the Nation address. As you can see right behind me, quite busy already here at the North Wing lobby, where senators, members of the House of Representatives, as well as several cabinet members are already making their way through to the plenary hall where the president is expected to deliver his speech at 4 p.m. later this afternoon. A while ago, Ron, we already saw Executive Secretary Lucas Bersamin and several other cabinet secretaries, including Finance Secretary Benjamin Diokno, DFA Secretary Enrique Manalo, as well as DICT Secretary Ivan Uy. But unfortunately, they skipped the red carpet and instead went straight to their holding room at the North Wing lobby. But we also have other secretaries here waiting in line for them to be interviewed after our live report here. Aside from that, Ron, what we do know is that we spoke to several congressmen who passed through here at the North Wing lobby. But let's keep our focus on some Mindanaoan politicians that we spoke to. We spoke to Bangsamoro Chief Minister Ahod Ibrahim, who told us that the Bangsamoro is quite satisfied with the performance of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. in the past year. He says that he is happy, the Bangsamoro is happy, that the president decided to retain their ministers during the extension period, as well as noting that the poverty rate has already improved in the Bangsamoro, with investments now at around 5% in the once battle-torn region. We also spoke to House Deputy Speaker and also Davao Representative Isidro Ungab, who tells us that Davao City, the bailiwick of Vice President Sara Duterte, is also very happy with the investments that the administration has brought to their region. The Davao representative says so far the alliance between the Ilocanos and the Davaoenos remains strong, but notes that it's too early to predict what will happen in the run-up to the midterm elections. Here's that statement. Well, we seem to be having some technical problems here, meanwhile, despite that technical glitch, what we can tell you so far, Ron, is that interviews here are ongoing. We see several secretaries as well as several lawmakers still making their way through the plenary hall, and we expect doors to be closed at around 3 p.m. That's about an hour before the president's speech begins at 4 p.m. As for the highlights of his speech later, cabinet secretaries have been quite mum about what we can expect from the president's second State of the Nation address. But as we mentioned in earlier newscasts, if we would base it on the key projects that he visited days before his second State of the Nation address, we expect the president to mention the signing of the Maharlika Investment Fund, the near construction of a specialty medical center in Pampanga, as well as his new governance slogan of Bagong Pilipinas. So far, that's the latest here from the Batasang Pambansa. Ron.
Katrina Domingo with the updates from the Batasang Pambansa. Thanks, Kat. Manila's Defense Secretary expects a modernization of the Philippine military and the proposed pension reform to dominate President Ferdinand Marcos's report on the country's defense sector. Secretary Gibo Teodoro adds part of that modernization push is to look for non-traditional partners in beefing up the country's defense capabilities.
Our end, on the department's end, he will put the stress on effective modernization of our capabilities to deter any form of aggression. Let me once again clarify that our capabilities in the armed forces of the Philippines and the defense establishment are not directed towards any country, but on the overall integrity of our security arrangements, facilities, and capabilities. This range from our upgrading our human capability skills to our equipment. And we've noticed also that there needs to be an improvement in project execution and integration of our human and command and control systems with our equipment.
The Philippine Environment Secretary believes the Marcos administration continues to prioritize preservation of life and environment. Secretary Tony Luzaga says the department has established their natural resource balances as well as reintroduced science back into their office after Marcos's first State of the Nation address. Luzaga is also confident Marcos will continue to push for the intersectional development of the environment and community.
This is a president that understands the linkage between climate change, biodiversity, water, public safety and health, as well as energy security and food security as well. So here we have a president that understands intersectionality in terms of the environment and what it can bring to our communities.
A historian weighs in on what the Filipino people could expect from President Marcos's second State of the Nation address. The likely themes of Marcos's speech: confidence and rebirth, according to Manolo Quezon.
That was actually a theme that was explored in the president's campaign, but now it's sort of going to be the trademark for all the activities. We also know from the president himself that one of the sort of anchors of his forthcoming second State of the Nation address is the renewed confidence and role of the Philippines on the global stage. This is one where he has shown the most self-confidence and perhaps even delight and pleasure in the job, and one which stands in marked contrast to his predecessor. The other thing, of course, that we'll be looking at is the dynamics within the president's coalition.
Quezon adds the Filipino people will also be eager to hear if former President Rodrigo Duterte's recent visit to China will be mentioned in Marcos's speech.
Considering one of the themes is the president's pride in his performance in foreign affairs, is how that Beijing trip will be acknowledged, if it will be acknowledged, and what the president will say about it, because of course it was a very significant move.
Finance Chief Benjamin Diokno says the Philippines is on the right track to achieving its economic targets. The passing of the Maharlika Investment Fund, as well as lower than anticipated debt-to-GDP ratio, are among what Diokno says are the country's economic achievements. The finance chief also lauds government's efforts to ease inflation. Diokno expects inflation will fall within the government's target of 2-4% by the end of this year. He notes the country has achieved a lot, but there is still more work to be done.
In our conversation with foreign investors abroad, while on our roadshows, I think there's a lot of interest on the Philippines. As you know, the Philippines right now is the fastest growing country in this part of the world, and which means maybe globally it's one of the fastest growing countries in the world. And I want to see the Philippines to be competitive with its ASEAN peers, okay? Mm-hmm. Which means we got to invest heavily, continue investing heavily in physical infrastructure and connectivity. We have to invest heavily in human capital, meaning our young kids, okay? This is our most important resource. We have to educate them and we have to provide sufficient health care for them. And then we also have to continue to strengthen our political and government institutions, which is also one of our biggest assets in this part of the world.